So let's talk today. We want to talk about my subject today is love roller coaster. Because there is a mandate, an expectation from God for your life, for my life, it means we all get to participate in God's kingdom, whether you're married, whether you're single, whether you're single again, male, female, it doesn't matter. Because God's mandate for expanding his influence in the earth begins with relationships, the enemy attacks relationships. Am I making sense to you? To the degree that you can get in and operate in healthy relationships is the degree to which you can fulfill God's purpose for your life. I think the one thing holding so many people back is the drama that they live within relationships. And it's a simple matter from this perspective. If you have to keep putting energy into drama, it's hard for you to put energy into destiny. Now, if you're on Twitter, help a brother out, because I may never be able to say it that way again. But if you have to keep investing your energy in drama, you take away from your ability to invest in your destiny. You can't be your best living in drama-filled relationships. Is anybody getting that? And many of you are living on what I call love roller coasters. It's kind of relationship where the love is up, the love is down. The love is in, the love is out. The love is hot, the love is... Okay, y'all with me? And it's time for you, whether you are married or single, to get off the love roller coaster. Because God has a destiny for you, and there's something God wants to do with you. If you are single, and this message will largely apply to singles, but not exclusively. If you are single, can I just tell you my goal today is to help you either get out of an unhealthy relationship or to not get into one. It's better for you to be by yourself than for you to be with somebody and be drama-filled. Ain't no drama. Well, no, let me take that back. I was going to say ain't no drama if it's just you, but for some of y'all, you so full of drama, you can do drama all by yourself. But I think you get my point. And so God wants you to be in a place where you're not shifted and moved and up and down and run around by love. And the best philosophers that I could find and discover to help us get this were the Ohio players. Let's hear the great philosophers. Young. Come on. Say what?
Say what?
Ooh, 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 ooh. Y'all, I like y'all don't know. Say what? You know what? They're not ready. They wanted to go to church, so they're so holy, they're going to act like they don't know the Ohio players. But the Ohio players said, your love is like a roller coaster. See, okay, some of y'all, come on with me and stop acting so holy and sanctified like you don't know what the Ohio player said. The Ohio player said, loving you is really wild. Now, it is a bit of a double entendre, but you know what I'm saying. And God wants you to be your best, and he realizes that you can't be your best on a roller coaster. You can't focus. You can't give your best energy. God has a destiny for you, and he has a life for you that requires that you get off the roller coaster. I want to share a few principles with you. In the last service, we only were able to cover three. There are five altogether, so I'm going to start with four and five. How about that? And then you can go onto the app this week and you can listen to both messages, Love Roller Coaster 1 and Love Roller Coaster 2. because you're going to need both of them. Say amen. Here's the first principle. How do you know you're on a love roller coaster? You live in a relationship where somebody is me-focused. You're with somebody who all they think about is them, themselves, and them. Their mantra is me, myself, and I. Come on and talk to me, somebody. And you're on a love roller coaster because they're not the least bit concerned about what you need. They're not the least bit concerned about what pains you, what interests you. Their main conversation concerns them. Has anybody ever been around selfish people? I'm trying to tell you, singles in particular, if you are dating somebody or if you're in love with somebody who's more in love with them than you are. Try that. Let me slow that down for you. If they are more in love with themselves than you are, you're on a love roller coaster with somebody who can't think of anybody but themselves. One of the things that happens when you're with a person who is me-focused is they have a way of making you feel unimportant. That nothing you bring to the conversation or to the table is valuable, significant, meaningful. Oh, somebody's going to get delivered right now. I feel a relationship breaking up right now. It's about six of them in this service. You're like, that's what that was. Yeah, they're just focused on themselves, and you feel unimportant, you feel invisible, and nothing you do is ever right or enough. Woo. I want to backtrack for a moment. I want to say to the married people who are parents or single who have lived in love roller coasters and you have children. Your children will do not what you say, but what you do. And when you live on a love roller coaster around your children, I don't care what you say, how much you go to church, how much you preach, and how much you tell them to read the word, they're going to jump on a love roller coaster with somebody when it's time, probably too soon. And the same drama they saw you living out, they're going to live out. Y'all not going to help me preach in here. And so if for no other reason, you need to get off the love roller coaster for the sake of the kids so that the kids can begin to see what healthy is. They can see what no drama looks like. Preach, Pastor. That's okay. I know I'm preaching. Listen, if you keep asking yourself questions like, how did I get into this? And how do I get out of this? And how long am I going to have to stay in this? That's an indication that you are on a love roller coaster. At the very next stop, tell the guy who removes the bar to let you off. You got to get off because you can't thrive this way. Am I making sense to anybody? Come with me. I want you to see this because some of you are connected with and hooked up to somebody who has they have the spirit of Diotrephes. Look at 3 John. 3 John. There's only one chapter in 3 John. And John says, I wrote to the church, but Diotrephes, somebody say Diotrephes, who loves to have the preeminence among them, does not receive us. There was what we would call a spirit of Diotrephes. And the spirit of Diotrephes says, I want to be first. The Bible says that Diotrephes had the disposition to be preeminent. It means diotrephes always wanted to be first. And you are connected with, some of you, somebody who always wants to be first. And they always think about themselves. And they always think about what you're not giving them and what you haven't done for them and how what you have done and have given is never enough. I'm preaching so good, right? Don't say it, man. I understand. You're in the counseling session right now. And so you're contemplative. But I want you to understand that this counseling session is $150 an hour. I'm just messing. Are you following what I'm saying to you, though? That you cannot be your best in a relationship with Diotrephes, who must be preeminent. Paul called it this way, and I think it's very similar. You don't have to turn here, but in Galatians 5, chapter 5, verse 20, Paul says the outworkings or the works of the flesh is selfish ambition. And Paul says, the works of the flesh include a number of things, but he said selfish ambition. This selfish ambition is a very unique word. It is a word that means to have it's almost like having electoral ambitions. A politicking spirit, so that the person is always trying to maneuver and manipulate to get people to see them and to vote for them. Who am I preaching to in here? And Paul, he calls it this. Here's the word. It says that they have an electioneering spirit. They're fractious is what the definition means. I had to look up fractious. Fractious means that they're quarrelsome, irritable, and hard to control. If you're with somebody who has a fractious spirit, they're quarrelsome, they're irritable, they're difficult to control, then you are with somebody who has selfish ambitions. And listen to me, you will never be able to convince them to make you a legitimate ambition in their life. That's why a lot of people in their marriages after the medical career or the legal career gets off the ground. Ooh, this is way too much for y'all. Because a person with an electioneering spirit have you do everything to help them move forward. And when they get to where they always wanted to get to, when they're finally elected, ooh, this is so good right here. Can I get a copy of this on DVD somewhere at a church near me? As soon as they get to where they wanted to get to, they have no more need for you, so you're not the showpiece that they once needed to get where they, my God. And the reason it has felt like a roller coaster along the way is because it is a roller coaster. And when they get to where they want to get to, they will put you off. You know you're on a love roller coaster when you live with a me-focused person. You know you're on a love roller coaster. Listen to me now. When the relationship you're in, it's unhealthy, but you can't let go. Ooh, it's going to get thick up in here. No, it's not going to get thick. It's already thick. You know you're on a love roller coaster. Listen now. When you know the relationship is not healthy, and you tried to get out, and every time you turn around, you back in. And really all y'all do is break up to make up. That's all y'all do. First y'all love each other. Then y'all hate each other. That's a game. I feel the Holy Ghost. Four fools. You got to stop playing that game. How is it that you, how is it that you're selfish and you're controlling and you're manipulative and we're not getting anywhere, and I keep coming back to you and leaving you and coming back to you? Have y'all seen people who date each other for 30 years? Off and on? Let me put my head down and keep going. Y'all looking at me strange. Paul says, here's part of the solution. Let me give you this. Galatians 5:1, you don't have to turn there. I'm going to just read it. I'm reading in all New King James today. I know normally we do the NIV typically, but he says, stand fast, therefore, in the liberty. Somebody say the liberty. By which Christ has made us free. And do not be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Now, Paul is obviously speaking concerning legalism and people who had found their freedom in Christ. They gave their lives to Christ. And these legalizers came along and said, no, but you got to keep all these rules. But the same principle applies to our relationships. God has made some of you free. You have found your faith in the Lord, and you started moving on a trajectory of understanding and embracing who God says you are and your value and your worth. And when you have a breakdown in your spirit, you keep turning back to the person who is toxic to you. Somebody shout, get out. Get out, get out. Married people like me too? No. Slow your roll. The solution for you is different. Because some of y'all was like, ooh, I had the papers all ready. I had them all set up and ready to go. Not quite so fast. And by the way, if you're married in a relationship like that, my heart breaks for you because it is oppressive and it's painful and it snatches the hope out of you 1 ounce at a time all day long. But God has more for you, and we're going to talk about that as we go along. Here's a question I want to ask for those of you who keep getting caught up with this kind of relationship. Have you become conditioned to pain so well, so much, that being by yourself feels more painful to you than being with somebody who can't love you? That's what I was trying to figure out as I was looking at these principles. Like, why do people keep running back to toxic relationships? And I think it's because people become conditioned by pain. Much like I pulled up to somebody's house the other day. I was out with my camera taking pictures. I asked them if I could take pictures on their property or something. They had a really, there's a beautiful scenery there. And I asked if I could take, and the dog came running to me. And I noticed that the dog, when he got to a certain point, stopped. Which indicated to me that I could come right up to about there and get my picture, because he had a little box around his neck. And when he got too close to the line, he went, and he backed up. And I wonder how many people become so conditioned to pain that rather than go across the line and be single again and be healthy, I'm preaching real good right about now. I'm looking for some love offers. I'm just telling y'all. You can pay the love offering. You can pay the counseling fee. I wonder how many people are afraid that if they cross the threshold into being single again, would think, because they've been conditioned, that it's better to be in a broken relationship than no relationship at all. I want you to grab somebody near you and tell them, you're going to be all right. You're going to be all right. You tell them you can do bad all by yourself.